Hi friends, here in this video I'll be explaining a problem on reheat cycle. So let's get started. Now here is the question given. It is said, in a reheat cycle, steam at 500 degrees Celsius expands in HP turbine till it is saturated vapor. Now first I'll explain the reheat cycle with the help of a layout and write the data on that layout. Mentioning the type of cycle first. So here is the diagram of a simple reheat cycle. In this, basically we have two turbines. One is the HP turbine, high pressure turbine, other is a low pressure turbine. So steam which is coming out from this boiler goes into the HP turbine first, there it gets expanded and then it leaves the turbine. I'll mention it with the help of notations. So when the steam is entering the high pressure turbine, that is point number one. And when it is expanding and leaving the high pressure turbine, that is point second. Then at point second, it enters a device which is called as the reheater. So here is the reheater in which the heat would be supplied. I'll denote it as QS2 because in the boiler, the steam, the heat which is supplied is QS1. So in the reheater, the steam is heated again. And the heating may be external, it can be external heating. So when the steam gets reheated, it is leaving the reheater at point number 3. So the pressure and temperature of the steam increases. And then it may also happen that in the reheater, the pressure may remain constant, the temperature may change. Means reheat is also possible with a constant temperature and it can even occur with a pressure difference as well. So the steam now at point number 3, it enters the low pressure turbine. Again it gets expanded and leaves the low pressure turbine at point 4. So we can see that since both the turbines, they are coupled with the common shaft, so we are getting the total work or the shaft work at the turbine is the work which is produced by the HP turbine and the work which is produced by the low pressure turbine, LP turbine, both are added. At point 4, it enters the condenser wherein the cooling water is circulated and we get the exhaust steam which is at point 4. It gets converted into saturated liquid. So after point 4, we have point 5. And then at point number 5, it is fed to the feed pump, wherein it is pumped from point number 5 to point 6. And at point number 6, it enters the boiler. So this is the complete reheat cycle. Now whatever data is given in the problem, I'll write on this reheat cycle. And basically this is used to increase the net work output of the steam power plant. And now, in a reheat cycle, steam at 500 degrees Celsius expands in HP turbine. So the initial temperature of the steam is given and that initial temperature in HP turbine is indicated with 0.1. So the temperature is T1. So T1 is given, which is 500 degrees Celsius. Then it expands in HP turbine till it is saturated vapor. So after the expansion in the high pressure turbine, at the exit what we are getting, it is the saturated vapor, also called as the dry saturated vapor. It means the dryness fraction of the steam at point number second, it is equal to 1. It means it is completely dry. So the condition of the steam is given at the exit. Next it is said, it is reheated at constant pressure. So the pressure in the reheater is constant to 400 degrees Celsius. So the reheating temperature means it enters the reheater at point 2, leaves at point 3. So the pressures are same, reheat pressure. And then it is leaving the reheater at temperature of T3, which is given as 400 degrees Celsius. After that, it enters the LP turbine and then expanded in the LP turbine to 40 degrees Celsius. So in the low pressure turbine, the temperature is given at the exit, that temperature is 40 degrees Celsius. Then if the maximum moisture content is 15% at the turbine exhaust, so it means after the exhaust from the LP turbine, because we are not going to take the exhaust of HP turbine because that is a dry steam, they have mentioned that after the exhaust, the steam is having a moisture content of 15%. So if moisture is there of 15%, so the remaining 85% of steam is dry steam. It means the dryness fraction is 85%, so it means 0.85. So the dryness fraction of the steam is given after it is exhausted at point number 4 in the low pressure turbine. That dryness fraction is 85%, or I can say 0.85. Then we have to calculate the reheat pressure. Reheat pressure is either P2 or P3. So both are same. So the first question is, we have to find either P2 or P3, the reheat pressure. Second question is, pressure of steam at inlet to HP turbine. So at inlet to HP turbine means point number 1. So the pressure is P1, which we have to find out. Then the net specific work output. So net specific work output is W dot net, or we can say simply W net, but dot we have to add if mass flow rate of steam is given. Next, cycle efficiency, steam rate. Steam rate is denoted by SR, also called as specific steam consumption. So we have to find out the specific steam consumption, and it is said, assume all ideal processes. It means expansion is isentropic in both the turbines, and neglect pump feed work. So we have to neglect the pump work. It means here in this problem, they have said that pump work is to be taken as 0. Why it is neglected? Because compared to the turbine work, the pump work is very small, so almost negligible, and that has been neglected. Now once the setup of the problem has been understood, I'll draw the HS diagram. And HS diagram is the Mollier chart, so I'm going to draw it rough and then explain what are the enthalpies which we have to calculate. Because when we see this diagram, there are 6 major points. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. All these 6 enthalpies need to be calculated in order to solve the problem. So first drawing the HS diagram in the solution part. So this is the HS diagram. Enthalpy is in terms of kilojoule per kg, entropy kilojoule per kg Kelvin. Here this curve is indicating the saturation curve. This is the CP critical point where the phase transformation takes place. On the left hand side we have the liquid line, on the right hand side we have the vapor line. So the dryness fraction is x equal to 1. Then I'll draw 3 pressure lines, because here there are 3 pressures in the problem. And remember, these pressure lines need to be of diverging nature. Diverging nature pressure lines. Here the highest pressure is the boiler pressure. The lowest pressure condenser pressure. and the pressure in between is the reheat pressure. Now, for point number one, the pressure value we don't have, but the temperature is given. So this line is indicating a temperature of 500 degrees Celsius, where it is going to intersect the boiler pressure at that location. I am going to get 0.1. So from 1 to 2, the steam gets expanded in the high pressure turbine. At the entering point, it is at 500 degrees Celsius, and when it is leaving, it is dry. It is mentioned in the problem, also shown in the data. So at point number 2, the steam should be on this dry saturation curve. Next, it is reheated till the temperature is 400 degrees Celsius. So like 500 degrees Celsius line, we have another line which is of 400 degrees Celsius, and where this 400 degrees Celsius line intersects the reheat pressure, I am going to get 0.3. So from 2 to 3, it is the reheating process. And then at 0.3, it enters the low pressure turbine, and again it gets expanded till it is wet with a dryness fraction of 0.85. So this is point number 4, and here is the dryness fraction of this 0.4. This dryness fraction is 0.85 at point number 4, that has been mentioned in the question. Now, these enthalpies H1, H2, H3 and H4, I am going to get it from the Mollier chart, because that is the simplest way from which we can calculate these enthalpy. And we are not going to start with point number 1 first, because we don't have boiler pressure. That is one of the question. We have to find the boiler pressure. We don't have a reheat pressure as well. So I cannot start from the top, because I need the intersecting point. So in this problem, at point number 4, the dryness fraction is given 0.85, and even the temperature is given of 40 degrees Celsius. So taking the temperature of 40 degrees Celsius, go into the steam table. That is, I'll say that therefore at temperature T4, which is 40 degrees Celsius, from steam table, I am going to get the pressure value. So look into the temperature table. Here is the steam table, in which the first temperature table is the temperature table. So go into the steam table, in table 1, where we have temperature table, look for the temperature. The temperature given here is 40 degrees Celsius. So here we have 40 degrees Celsius temperature. Go for the pressure. At 40, the pressure is 0.07375 bar. I am writing pressure P4. Now, why this approach is being used here? Because 40 degrees Celsius on the Mollier chart, we are not going to get it directly. As we can see here, when the temperature lines are there, we have a temperature of, after 200 degrees Celsius, we have 150 degrees Celsius. And here also, when we see these temperature lines, at final, the temperature, the last temperature is of 50 degrees Celsius. And below that, we don't have any temperatures. So the approach is to go for the pressure corresponding to that same location, and the pressure is 0.07375 bar, which is very much close to 0.07 bar pressure, and the dryness fraction is 0.85. So what I'll do here is, onto the Mollier chart, searching for pressure of 0.07. here we have 0.01, 0.02, 0.03, 0.04, 0.05, and here we have 0.1. So the pressure will lie between 0.05 and 0.1. Now this pressure line is not there directly of 0.07, so that I am going to draw. So it is better to take the average of this, that is 0.05 and 0.01.
0.1. So the average is 0.05 plus 0.1. The average is 0.075 bar, which is very much close to the value which we have. So I can say that this pressure is approximately equal to 0.075 bar. Now, once we know that the pressure line will lie between 0.05 and 0.1, so I have to draw a pressure line in between them parallelly. So I am drawing a line which is parallel to the pressure line in between them. It is almost going to lie on this constant volume line, because that is the center of this. So here I am drawing a line corresponding to 0.075 bar parallel to the pressure lines. So here this line which I have drawn in red, that indicates a pressure of 0.075 bar. Next is to search for the dryness fraction, which is 0.85 given in the problem. So here is the dryness fraction of 0.85. So the intersection of this pressure line with the dryness fraction line of 0.85 gives me point number 4. So here is point 4. Now I have, after getting point 4, looking at this HS diagram, because similar to it we are going to get it on the Mollier chart. After point 4, I have to go vertically up, and where this vertical line intersects a temperature of 400 degrees Celsius, I am going to get point number 3. So projecting this same point 4 upwards, so drawing a light line. Now where this vertical line is intersecting a temperature of 400 degrees Celsius, at this location I am getting point number 3. So here is point 3, and then see that if any of the pressure line is passing through that point, I can clearly see that there is a pressure line of 20 bar. Here we can see there is 20 bar pressure line which is passing through this point, which is point number 3. So onto the diagram we can see, from point 3 following this same line I'll reach the saturation curve, and that will give me point number 2. So following the same pressure line of 20 bar, I am getting point number 2nd, which is over here. And now this point 2nd would be projected up to a temperature of 500 degrees Celsius, so that I get point number 1. So point number 2 will be projected upwards up to a temperature of 500 degrees Celsius. So here I am getting point number 1. And now when I quickly summarize this, from point 1 to 2 we are getting the expansion in high pressure turbine. From 2 to 3 there is reheating in the reheater up to 400 degrees Celsius temperature as mentioned in the problem. This is point 3. And from 3 to 4 there is expansion in the low pressure turbine up to point number 4. Now what I'll do here is, after we have all the 4 points, I'll first take the enthalpy values and then write it and then move forward. So the enthalpy of point number 1 is projected. This point number 1 needs to be projected either on the left side or right side, because both are indicating enthalpy values. I'm getting the value as 3300. There may be chances of plus or minus 10% error, which is acceptable since it is the graphical method. So I can say that now, therefore, from the Mollier chart, H1 is 3300, then H2 value for that year is point number 2, and when I am projecting it, I am getting the enthalpy value is 2800. Kilojoule per kg. Similarly, I am going to get H3 and H4 values as well. H3 value. Each boxes are of 10 kilojoule per kg on this Mollier chart for enthalpy. Now, here the value is 3200 and point number 3 is, I am counting the boxes. It is 5 boxes above, so the value is 3250 kilojoule per kg for point number 3. Then H4 value. It is 2200 kilojoule per kg. Now, after getting the enthalpy values, even the question is we have to find how much is the boiler pressure, which is P1, and the reheat pressure denoted by P2 and P3, both are same because reheating is at constant pressure. So the line, pressure line passing through point 2 and 3 will give me the reheat pressure, and that is also from the Mollier chart. So I can say that therefore P2 equal to P3 will be, here this is the pressure line and that pressure line is of 20 bar pressure. As I have explained, this is the 20 bar pressure line. So that's the reheat pressure. And next we have to find the boiler pressure denoted by P1. Boiler pressure will be the pressure line passing through point number 1. And we can see from point number 1 there is a pressure line which is corresponding to 150 bar pressure. This is corresponding to 150 bar pressure. So therefore P1 is 150 bar. And these are the two answers that is asked in the problem. The reheat pressure 20 bar and the pressure at the inlet to the HP turbine, that is 150 bar. So into the data, when I am looking, P2 and P3 values are found out, P1 is found out. Now we have to find the remaining terms. And for that, the remaining enthalpies are needed. So I'll complete the diagram. That whatever is there from the Mollier, we have got the 4 enthalpies and the pressures. Now Mollier chart won't be used. We are going to use the steam table for the further part of the problem. And now in order to complete the diagram, after reaching point 4, point 4 is the exit from LP turbine, and after that the steam enters the condenser. So from 4 to 5 is condensation, we are going to get saturated liquid. So after point 4, following the same pressure, because condensation takes place at constant pressure, we reach up to the saturated liquid line, and at 5 it enters the feed pump, from where it is pumped to the boiler. So the pressure increases from the condenser pressure to the boiler pressure. And 5 to 6 indicates the pumping in the feed pump. And from 6 to 1 the heat is added in the boiler. So that is the complete diagram, complete HS diagram. From 6 to 1 heat is supplied in the boiler, and then 2 to 3 the heat is supplied in the reheater. So we have two heat additions. Heat is rejected in the condenser. Now after getting 4 enthalpies, for point number 5, go into the steam table, look for pressure of 0.075 bar. So therefore from steam table, at pressure of 0.075 bar, I am going to get the HF value, and that HF value will be the enthalpy of 0.5. Will be the HF value, because that is the saturated liquid. So in the steam table, go into the pressure table. in the pressure table, look for pressure of 0.075 bar. So in the steam table, looking into the pressure table, I have to search for pressure 0.07. Now I can see that there is a pressure of 0.07 bar. And after that, there is directly a pressure of 0.08 bar. So 0.075 is not there, but still we can find the enthalpy value of 0.075 bar. Since it is exactly in the middle, so we can take the average value. So here, how I'm going to find, I'll write the value corresponding to pressure of, first, when the pressure is 0.07 bar, the enthalpy HF is 163.4 kilojoule per kg. At pressure 0.08, it is 173.9. Since the value which we want, that is 0.075, is exactly in the middle of these values, so take the average of these values and the answer is, it is 168.65 kilojoule per kg. If we want, we can even find from the interpolation method as well. Now, after getting the enthalpy of 0.5, since they have mentioned that pump work is to be neglected or it is taken as zero, so since the pump work is zero, it is given, and therefore that same pump work is H6 minus H5 because the pump is operating between 0.5 and 6. So therefore I can say that H6 is equal to H5 because pump work is zero. So whatever the enthalpy of 0.5 we have got, same would be the value for 0.6 as well. Now once all the enthalpies are known, we can find whatever is asked in the question. And the question was to get the net work. For that, the turbine and pump work are to be found out. So I'll say that first, since turbine work is given by, and it is the calculation of turbine work. Turbine work denoted by W suffix T, and that is also the total turbine work. So therefore the total turbine work is the work produced by high pressure turbine plus the work produced by the low pressure turbine, since here we have two turbines. High pressure turbine is having enthalpy drop off from H1 to H2. So the enthalpy drop is corresponding to the work produced. That much amount of work is produced by the turbine, plus work for low pressure turbine is H3 minus H4. So H1 value was 3300, H2 value 2800, H3 3250, H4 2200. So from this I am going to get the turbine work, which is total turbine work, and the answer is 1550 kilojoule per kg. So that's the turbine work. Similarly, I need to find the net work, and net work would be turbine work minus the pump work. So calculation for W net, that is the net work. Now since the net work is equal to the turbine work minus the pump work, in the problem they have mentioned that pump work is zero, so therefore W net is nothing but it is equal to the turbine work. Why? Because since pump work is zero, it is given. So whatever the turbine work which I have calculated now, 1550, that is nothing but the net work. So that is one of the answers. That's the third answer after the reheat pressure and boiler pressure. The next question is to get the cycle efficiency after W net. Cycle efficiency can be calculated once we know the heat supplied in the boiler and in the reheater. So the calculation part would be calculation for total heat supplied denoted by QS. So therefore I can say that QS, the total heat supplied, will be equal to QS1, heat supplied in the boiler, plus QS2, the heat supplied in the reheater.
Now, heat supplied in the boiler can be explained in this way, that water enters at 0.6, leaves at 0.1 as steam. So H1 minus H6 plus in the reheater, the steam enters at 0.2, leaves at 0.3. So H3 minus H2, there is enthalpy increase in the reheater. So therefore, just putting the respective values, so the total heat supplied is 3581.35 kilojoule per kg. So that's the total heat supplied. Now therefore the cycle efficiency, since efficiency of the complete cycle is given by output, which is W net, upon the input, which is the total heat supplied, W net 1550, heat supplied 3581.35. So therefore the cycle efficiency is 0.4327. After the decimal, take the values up to the four places, then multiplying with 100, I'll get the efficiency in the form of percentage. So that is the efficiency of this plant, 43.27%. And at last, we have to find the steam rate or the steam consumption, specific steam consumption. So calculation for steam rate, also called as the specific steam consumption. So that steam rate or the specific steam consumption is given by, the formula is, it is 3600 upon W net. So therefore we have 3600 upon W net, multiplying with this 3600 in the numerator will give me the answer in terms of per hour. So basically this comes out to be 2.32, and the unit is, since it is steam rate, it is kg per kilowatt hour. So for every 1 kilowatt power produced in 1 hour, the steam consumption is 2.32 kg, that is indicated by the steam rate. And once the steam rate also has been calculated, all the questions have been answered, and with that the problem on reheat cycle gets completed. At the end, if you all find my videos helpful, you all can like, share, comment and subscribe our channel and share it amongst your family and friends. Thanks for watching.